Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory is a National Cancer Institute designated cancer center, and we have been so for the past 25 years. Over 50% of the research at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory is focused on cancer research. And in addition to breast cancer, we're working on a large number of other cancers, including brain cancer, pancreatic cancer, leukemia, lymphoma, prostate cancer, melanoma, ovarian cancer, and lung cancer, to name just a few. Our research is consistently rated highly by independent surveyors, and in fact, we are rated number one by Thomson Reuters for our efforts in molecular biology and genetics, and that's due to the impact that our research papers have in their respective fields. So not only are we doing fantastic research right here in your local neighborhood, but we're having a tremendous impact throughout the world in cancer research as well as in research in other areas. I think it's very appropriate tonight that we have this discussion on breast cancer, as all of us have a family member, friend, neighbor, or colleague that has been affected with this disease. And while we have made terrific strides over the past 10 or 20 years at trying to impact breast cancer, we still have a long way to go. Our next speaker is Dr. Mikala Egeblad. Mikala is an assistant professor here at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. She's running an amazing breast cancer research program using imaging-based approaches to understand how the immune system is impacting the tumor and how chemotherapeutics impact that interaction. I'm delighted to say that Mikala recently received a highly competitive Department of Defense Era of Hope Scholar Award from their breast cancer program, and this grant is provided to individuals who are the best and brightest in their fields with a high potential of innovation and making breakthrough findings. So we're really delighted to have Mikala as a colleague here at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory, and it's my pleasure to introduce her to speak with you tonight.
Thank you very much. I think we've lost the pointer here. Okay, there we go. So what I'm going to talk about today may be different from the kind of breast cancer research that you've seen before. What you have here behind me is one of these images that we have acquired from inside a living mouse. So we are watching in real time what's happening in breast cancer. What you're seeing here in blue, that's the tumor. In green, we have the inflammatory cells that you're going to see a lot more about in this presentation. And in red, we have the drug we are trying to treat the tumor with. And you can already see that one of the problems we are having is that the drug may come in some areas, but in other areas of the tumors is not getting in. So, as I think is the case for everyone in the audience here today, breast cancer is a personal issue for me. This is me when I was much smaller, and my grandmother. And my grandmother is a very typical example of the issue we are facing. Like most women, at the time of diagnosis, there was no evidence, no clinical evidence of a metastatic disease. But as is the case for 2 out of 10, the cancer came back despite surgery and despite adjuvant treatment, in her case, anti-estrogen treatment. And when it comes back, it can be very late, and that's one of the things that, of course, is concerning everyone that's a survivor with breast cancer, that it's really very hard to ever feel safe when you've had breast cancer. When it comes back, it often comes back in many different tissues, such as in the lung, the liver, the lymph node, or the bone. So in other words, it has metastasized or spread to other organs. And what we're trying to do in my laboratory is to try to address these problems. How do we make sure that the tumor that comes back doesn't metastasize and that it's not resistant to treatment? How do we get it so that we can cure everything in these early cases? So normally when a breast cancer researcher tries to attack that problem, what is done typically is to take out the tumor and try to generate cancer cells that we can study in the petri dishes in the laboratory and try to test different drugs and see which drugs kill the cancer cells and which drugs do not. And there's been major breakthroughs through that approach. We can go even deeper and try to do an analysis of the genes that are different in the cancer cells and find ways, vulnerabilities in the cancer cells, way to attack them. And you heard in the previous talk about ways that that have led to breakthroughs, and you're gonna hear another very elegant study after my talk. But the first thing that happens when a breast tumor is cut out is that a little piece of it is being brought to a microscopic slide, and a pathologist will be looking at the piece of the tumor. And what you can see here is that a breast tumor is more than just the cancer cells. It's a tissue. So we have the cancer cells here in blue, and interspersed between them, you see these immune cells, inflammatory cells colored in brown, so the pathologist can recognize them. And you can see there's also blood vessels within these tumors. So there are many different components in the cancer, and they are clearly speaking to each other. But when we take out slides and look at it in the microscope, it's just a still image. It's dead tissue and a snapshot. And we don't really know what happened before. What was the result of this interaction? We don't know what happens afterwards. So to try to understand that, we are taking advantage of some very basic research that were generated originally by a marine biologist. And they had no idea that this was going to help cancer research when it did it. And I think that's why it's so important that we support basic research. So they discovered that there's a gene in a type of jellyfish that make the jellyfish fluoresce. And this gene was isolated, and another group of researchers got the idea that maybe it could be transferred into organism and make them glow so that you could follow the cells that had this gene in real time in living organisms such as the mouse you're seeing here. And a third group of scientists then figured out that they could modify these genes and get different colors, green, blue, red, purple, yellow even, and have different cells glow in different types so that we could see how they were interacting. So we have taken this approach and generated mice that have all these different colors in different cell types, and now we're putting the mouse on the microscope. It's live, so we have it anesthetized, and rather than watching a dead tissue, we are watching on the computer screen the live tissue here, and you saw some examples out in the hallway. So what you're having here is a tumor. The tumor cells are colored in blue. You have the inflammatory immune cells here in green, and you can see that they're moving through the blood vessel that we have labeled red. So what can we use this technology to? I told you that I really wanted to understand why tumors are not responding better to the treatment we have. So the first thing we tried to do was to take such a mouse on the microscope and treat it with chemotherapeutic treatment and see what happened. And the first thing we noticed is shown here. We have the drug, chemotherapeutic drug, is colored red, and we can follow how it gets out of the blood vessel. They're colored in green, and you can see how individual cancer cells are lighting up as the drug gets inside the cell. And what is striking is that area of the tumors where we get a lot of drug in, and then there's areas where there's very little drug. And so it's not surprising that areas that see very little drug are not going to respond very well to the drug. We need a certain concentration, certain dose of the drug to kill them. So that is clearly one of the issues we are facing. But another thing we also saw and observed much later, what you just saw were the first hour after we injected the drug, came much later. So what you're seeing here is about 30 hours after we treated the mouse with the chemotherapeutic drug, and we watched them for up to 40 hours. You have here a region of the tumor. We used a trick, so all the dead cells are now labeled in red, and you can see we were quite successful. In this region, most of the cells were killed. But there's also some cells here that were not killed. They're alive, they're still glowing in the blue color. So in mice as well as in women, we need multiple doses of chemotherapy to get it to work. So I remember this movie as if it was yesterday, because at around 4 a.m. in the night, what I saw was these inflammatory cells coming in here around the region where we have all the dead cells. But look how they're also up here around the area where we have the live cells. So when we saw this infiltration of inflammatory cells into the tumor tissue, we are naturally wondering, what are they doing? Is that a good thing or is it a bad thing? So to address that, we need to take a step back and think about what are inflammatory cells really doing in the body. And this is an example where we infected a mouse with a fluorescent labeled red bacteria. You can see the bacteria is all over here. And when I start the movie, you can see that the inflammatory cells are going through the blood vessel and they're seeking out the bacteria. They're getting out of the vessel and they're running right towards them. And when you come here in higher magnification, what you'll see is that not only do they find the bacteria In a moment, one of these cells is going to come in, and you'll see how it engulfs the bacteria one by one, takes them up and clear them and get rid of them. So these cells are really very important for us in our defense against bacterial infections. See the cell come in here again. But they have additional function. In the case of wound healing, these inflammatory cells are coming in first and they're cleaning out the bacteria, but then the wound need to close. And in order for that to happen, these inflammatory cells start a cascade at the wound healing process by sending out signals that make cells in the tissue proliferate so they can regenerate the tissue that was injured. They make the blood vessel sprout, so there will be new vessels to this new tissue. And then they start stimulating the movement of cells to come together to close a wound. This is all something we need, but the tumor can hijack this process, and it does so very commonly, because these signals that can stimulate cell proliferation and vessel growth are the same signal that the tumor then can exploit to increase its growth. And the signals that increase movement and closure of the wound can be exploited to promote metastatic spread. So that leads us back to the chemotherapeutic study. What are these inflammatory cells doing after chemotherapy? So to address that, we started treating mice, normal mice, and mice where we had genetically manipulated them so there was a reduced inflammation. And you can see when we treat with one of these drugs, the drug called doxorubicin, we can keep the tumor somewhat in check initially, and then it really takes off. But when we remove the inflammatory cells from the mouse, we can keep the tumor in check for much longer. So we're not curing the cancer, but we are keeping it stable for a longer time. Another drug called cisplatin, again, it's not that effective in a normal mouse, but if you take away the inflammatory cells, now we start to see shrinkage of the tumor. So what we are learning from this is we can start to play around with different drug combination and reduction of inflammatory cells and get a better response to the drugs we already have available. The question is, and that leads us to what I really want you to take home from this is that there are many different ways that drug resistance can occur. The classical way of thinking of drug resistance is that there's mutation in a subpopulation of cancer cells, and that this mutation result in resistance to a drug. But there are additional mechanisms, as I showed you. Some cells may not even see enough drug, and there are now several labs working on trying to get drugs deeper into the tumor, into the regions of the tumor that didn't see it. And I also showed you that these inflammatory cells are secreting survival signals, generating survival signals for cancer cells. So that's another way we can try to think about how drug resistance and all these different processes are really coming together, and we need to address them together to cure breast cancer. Can we do even better? Here I've shown that we can inhibit the inflammatory cells. But I've talked about how they have several different functions. And these inflammatory cells that I talked about, the ones you saw in the movies, they're actually called monocytes. It's one specific type of inflammatory cells. You can think of it sort of as a teenager that grows up to become another type, the macrophage, once it gets into the tissue. And in the tissue of the tumor, it gets these signals of wounds and becomes the tumor-promoting macrophages. But I also showed you that if there are signals on infections, it's a bacteria-killing macrophage. So what if we could make these bacteria-killing macrophages to tumor-killing macrophages? So a group of talented postdocs in my lab started thinking about this. It's a little bit like Clark Kent. He's ready to go, and he could be Superman, but the tumor takes him to the bar, and it ends really poorly. Can we get him off those alcoholic tendencies and get him back on track to help us? And so what we did here was take macrophages and cancer cells, and they're exactly the same cancer cells shown here in red and macrophages in green, same cells in these two culture dishes. This one, we are leaving them to their own devices and let them have their normal stimuli, that the normal signals that they are sending out. And as you can see, the cancer cells are growing happily. All these red cells are proliferating, and within 48 hours, they're taking over the entire culture dish. Over here, we are now giving the macrophages signals, so they think that they are a bacterial infection. And what you see is how they, one by one, attack the cancer cells. They kill them, and they eat them. And within 48 hours, we have almost completely cleaned up the petri dish of these cancer cells. So let me just show you here side by side. These are the same cells. All we did was trick them to think that there was a bacterial infection. So of course we want to try to see if we can take that into the patient. It's not trivial. There's a lot of side effects by triggering these bacterial infection signals. But I think it's worth a try because this is really dramatic, as you can tell. So I think that we are at a very exciting time. I've already shown you how looking at the tumor as a tissue and looking in real time is giving insights on how we may be able to delay or even prevent relapse by getting the drugs we already have at our disposal to work better by attacking this immune cell infiltration that I've shown you. And there are several different labs working on this and several different approaches that are already in phase 1 trial because of the encouraging results from the mouse studies. But we want to go further and we want to try to see what we can do to really address a metastatic disease and employ the ability of these immune cells that I've shown you, their ability to seek out and find the cancer cells and stop these signals of wound healing and instead activate the signals of cell killing so that we may be able to cure breast cancer. So I'd like to end by saying that I've never been more excited and inspired to be a breast cancer researcher than I am right now. I think we have some fantastic tools to our disposal. You may be aware that federal research funding is hard to come about these at the moment. It has been, the research field has been pretty hard hit. And so therefore, I'm very grateful for all the local support I've received. We have a saying in Danish, and I'm from Denmark, that many small streams together make a big river. And I have received so much support here from the local community, from $50 donations and up to hundreds of thousands. And it's really been very enabling. That support had helped my research program come off the track, and together with the insights and help I've gotten from Janet Price and Joanne Marquette, it really helped me secure the federal funding that David mentioned earlier so that we can take that research even further. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to answer questions after the next talk by Nicholas Tonks.